Oh, music is gone. So we're gonna wait for a couple of minutes until other people are coming in, and I'm going to. We start with a dance party.
Welcome all today, and welcome to the roundtable on building communities and technologies of care. Before we start, I would like to call Tom Worthington, who is our amazing assistant, to give us a little bit of our rules of engagement for tonight.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the fifth session of this speaker series, Who Cares? Sustaining Relations of Health Beyond Times of Crisis. My name is Tom Worthington, and myself, along with Shalika Sivathasan, will be moderating the event this evening. Before we begin, we just have a few notes about audience participation. Please ensure that your microphone is on mute throughout the event. There will be a Q&A session at the end. However, if you do have any questions before this point, we encourage you to send these directly to myself in the chat, and we will call on you to unmute yourself and ask your question once the Q&A begins. If you would prefer that I ask your question for you, you can send your question via a private message to myself in the chat, and I will do so. And if you're joining us via YouTube, you can also submit your questions in the chat there. A note on this event, it will also have subtitles, so that will be the live transcript option on Zoom. And a final reminder, as I mentioned, this event is being live streamed on YouTube and will be recorded there for later viewing. And I'll now pass things over to Elena.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you all for attending tonight. I know it's a Friday night and the weather is beginning, well, not tonight, but at least not here in Toronto. I'm going to start with a land acknowledgement, which is also an important, I want to tie it in with what we're about to do today. I'm joining you from Toronto today, and I'm joining you as a migrant settler in this city. This area is the ancestral and traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the First Credit, the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, and the Huron-Wendat, who are the original custodians of the land on which we stand and create. This territory is subject to the Dish with One Spoon, Wampum Belt Covenant, an agreement between the Iroquois Confederacy and the Confederacy of the Ojibwe and allied nations to peaceably share and care for the Great Lakes region. It is important to acknowledge the profound symbolism of the one dish and the one spoon at the heart of this covenant, if we are especially to honor what it asks of us going forward. One dish and one spoon indicate that we each partake of the abundance of the land with a responsibility towards sharing it with others in a manner that is respectful and careful. To eat from one dish with one spoon entails deep responsibility, respect, and care. Responsibility, respect, and care towards taking just enough from the plate and ensuring that there is enough for others. Responsibility, respect, and care for the shared tools, the spoon, through which we partake of the land's abundance. Although we may be meeting on a virtual platform today, this does not mean our meeting is placeless. In the midst of the winds of war now blowing from Europe, I encourage each and every one of us meeting here today to reflect on the complex webs of interdependence that sustain us, starting from the lands we find ourselves working on and in and in relation to, and from the deep ethics of relation and reciprocity that the covenant of its original peoples remind us of, so that we can in fact cultivate the kind of deep gratitude towards the land's life-giving powers that can truly orient us all towards a robust culture of care. My name is Elena Basile. I teach at the University of Toronto in the Sexual Diversity Program at University College and at York University in the Department of English in the School of Gender, Sexuality and Women's Studies and in the Master's Program in Translation Studies. And my co-organizer for Who Cares is Roberta Bouyani. She'll introduce herself.
Hi, my name is Roberta Bouyani, and I am a faculty in the Bilingual Program of Communications at York University, Glendon Campus. And I'm also a faculty at York College and at the Institute for the History of Philosophy and of Science and Technology at the University of Toronto. I'm also the artistic director of the Arts Eye Salon, which is a collective committed to fostering collaborations between the arts and techno-science based at the Fields Institute for Research in Mathematical Sciences. And I am saying this because between Elena and me and my other affiliations, we have put together this event thanks to the support of many institutes and also with our own affiliations, which are three institutions and more research units. So it is only thanks to them that we were able to pull out this this event. So together we created this speaker series to foster transdisciplinary conversations between doctors, writers, artists, and researchers, and more and more. And we chose specifically people who are both established and in training, and we are also involving our classes to participate. The event focuses broadly speaking on contemporary biopolitics of care and addresses the urgent need to move towards more respectful, creative, and inclusive social practices of care in the wake of the systemic crack made obvious by the pandemic. So in our fifth events, as Tom mentions. And the third roundtable of the series, we have an introduction to our two artist exhibitions, which will open respectively on March 31st, Alanna Kibbe, and who will be opening next, well, on the 31st on from 5 to 7 p.m. at the Canadian Language Museum on Glendon College campus. And there are instructions on our website. Or contact us if you have troubles finding it. It's very easy to find it. And then we will have another opening with Camille Baker on April the 7th. This one is downtown, and it's at the DGIV library at New College at the University of Toronto, which is on the Spadina line. So it's actually very easy to find as well. So if you've missed the previous events, you can actually see the recordings. And I saw that a lot of people went and reviewed the recordings. We have like over 100 people who view these recordings. So I'm actually very, very pleased by that. But please also come to see the live event itself. Now we will have also a final keynote conversation, which is going to be next week, and it's on the 1st of April, April's Fool, and it's going to be a conversation between Bayo Kumulafe and Sima Yasmin, a theorist and thinker, and epidemiologist and poets and so many other things together. And finally, we will have artist Karolina Sinjevic, who will close the series with an in progress project, which ends the series but starts our new project, which will take her maybe here in Toronto in a couple of years. So before we start, I also want to thank our supporters. As I said, this is an effort that spans through institutions. So York University, U of T, and University of Toronto, and the Fields Institute. I would like to thank the generous support of the Social Science and the Humanities Research Council of Canada, SHRC, New College at the University of Toronto, and the Faculty of Liberal Arts and Professional Studies at York University. We also wish to acknowledge the generous contributions of the Center for Feminist Research, Sensorium, Center for Digital Arts and Technology, the Canadian Language Museum, the Department of English, and the School of Gender and Women's Studies at York University, and the Ivy Library at New College, and the Institute for the History and Philosophy of Science and Technology at the University of Toronto. And a special thanks to the Fields Institute for Research in Mathematical Science, where I am based and where I run the Arts High Salon. And so this event, this series of events, is also co-hosted and co-sponsored by the Fields Institute and Arts High Salon. I don't see Nina here, but so this event is also a laser event. Nina is, as usual, if people know her, she's always extended. So she's actually in another meeting and she's trying to get out of it to join our meeting. But I would like to just say a few words. So Nina is the co-host with me of the Leonardo Laser Talks. This is a very big network that spans the entire world, and I'm actually very honored to be part of this network. But without further ado, I will pass the microphone to Elena again, so that she can introduce the speakers.
Thank you so much, Roberta. This continues to be for me an amazing experience, and I'm sure that the event tonight will continue to live up to its promises. So I want to start with a small introduction about what we've done so far, and somewhat how we thought about this particular event. So far in our speaker series roundtables, our conversations have revolved around a series of issues dogging contemporary healthcare sector and the culture that underlies it, which relies at its core on a few things, and I'm going to list them. It relies on its core on a systemic devaluation of the experience of illness, on a myopic and constant translation of thinking, feeling bodies into discrete bits of data that only intermittently coalesce into sentient wholes. It relies on an indiscriminate championing of technological fixes at the expense of cultivating practices of listening and attention to the lived experience of illness and vulnerability. And finally, it relies also, and this was something that emerged from our roundtable conversation, it relies on a very real and disheartening cultural illiteracy towards relating to death and to dying. Throughout our roundtables, we've listened to the voices of doctors, thinkers, and artists, all calling for the need not only to examine the terrible distortions and shortfalls of our system, but also to start building different approaches to care. The arts and artistic research in general play a crucial role in such a project of change, as they provide tools for bearing witness to the present and for educating our imaginations towards different horizons of the possible. The artists we meet in our roundtable today, Alanna Kibbe and Camille Baker, are both engaged in addressing the major questions of our series in relation to the pervasive gaps and biases that traverse cancer care today. And both proposed participatory forms of art oriented towards building educated publics and communities of care and advocacy, in which deep acknowledgement of the experience of pain is brought into being together with the recognition of our reciprocal interdependencies, without which we cannot sustain an authentic culture of care. Cancer today is possibly the most endemic of all illnesses, and yet the ways in which it is dealt with continue to perpetuate the most insidious and debilitating myths of militarized metaphors of cure at the expense of community-oriented cultures of care. From the pinkwashing corporate campaigns that induce people to run for cures without accountability to where their money is going, to the ongoing minimization of environmental factors contributing to the disease, to the facile suggestions that deep body losses imposed by surgery and chemotherapy can be easily fixed by wigs, implants, and prosthesis. Almost everything in contemporary cancer land, as Anne Boyer calls it, conjures to prettify, elide, and minimize the lived experience and agencies of people living in the wake of cancer. Both Camille and Alanna proactively address these problems by way of centering such lived experience and agency and suggesting that listening to them can be profoundly transformative. Before presenting each artist, I would like to read out the three questions that we asked them to consider in view of our talk tonight and our conversations tonight, and their presentations will partially address them. And we may return to these questions after their presentations, but for the time being, I just want to put them out there for the audience to know. So one question we asked in view of this roundtable was for each artist, what experiences, knowledges, and research does your work emerge from? And what aspects of care is it trying to address? The second question is the following: what major pitfalls, difficulties, and problems have you encountered in your experience and research when it comes to patients dealing with the protocols of cancer diagnosis, treatment, and care? How does your work address these issues? And three, how do your creative processes and your research connect to wider struggles towards building community-oriented cultures of care that center the illness experience, valorize community, and emphasize interdependence? So Roberta will introduce Camille, and then each artist will present for about 10 minutes, and then we will open the floor for everyone for conversations with the audience at large. Roberta.
Okay, the honor to introduce Camille Baker. She is an artist, performer, researcher, and curator within various art forms. She's done immersive experiences, participatory performance, and interactive art, mobile media art, tech fashion, a soft circuit, DIY electronics, and even more, responsive interfaces and environments, and emerging media curating. Maker of participatory performance and immersive artwork, Camille Baker develops methods to explore expressive nonverbal modes of communication, extended embodiment and presence in real and mixed reality and interactive art context using XR, haptics, e-textiles, wearable devices, and mobile media. She has an ongoing fascination with all things emotional, embodied, felt, sensed, the visceral, physical, and relational. Her 2018 book, New Directions in Mobile Media and Performance, showcases exciting approaches and artists in this space, as well as her own work. She has been running a regular meetup group with smart e-textile artists and designers since 2014 called E-Stitches, where participants share their practice and facilitate workshops of new techniques and innovations. Camille Baker also has been principal investigator for the EU-funded Starts ecosystem, which is very well known in the EU. I'm very looking forward for our installation, which is coming up soon at the University of Toronto, which hasn't come yet, but I know that it's somewhere in Mississauga waiting for delivery, probably tomorrow or Monday, I don't know. But anyway, applause for Camille.
Great. I didn't know if you wanted me to say anything at all at this moment or just say hello.
I don't know, Elena. Elena is the leader of today's roundtable. Yep.
We have it on our script too that I introduced Alanna, but I think we could actually do it that if you want to start presenting, and then when it's Alana's turn, I'll do the more proper presentation, so things are more vivid in the audience mind. So please go ahead and do your own spiel, and then we will present Alana, and then bring it.
Well, I mean, I'm happy to. Do the order that you've presented. Like, I'm happy to share now if you want, or I can wait. I'm completely open to what you want. So I have some slides though that I'd like to show if I'm presenting now.
Yes, if Alanna is okay that I'll present her when she presents, please do go ahead. And do you need access? You do have access.
Yeah.
So we can spotlight you.
Yeah, I've been spotlighted. I just wasn't entirely sure. So let me do this. There we go. So I used your title. I'm gonna speed through sort of my background to give you some context. I'm just gonna whiz through it just for ideas of things. So as Roberta mentioned, I do a lot of different things, and I'm a bit of a Jane of all trades, if you will, and have been exploring a lot of things related to the body and technology. And so this is a shopping list of things that I've been involved in. And in my research, they've always had a hard time pinning me down, figuring out which school to put me in and that kind of thing. But I see myself sort of at this sort of intersection. And since I'm working with the interface of technology and the body, it kind of makes sense, but it's across different mediums and different practices, sometimes put into design, sometimes put into fashion, sometimes put into textiles, sometimes performance, just all over the map, sometimes engineering. I've been in an engineering department. So I'm kind of all over the place. I started way back in the Middle Ages in performance as a dancer, and then I got into different forms of media and art, and Nina's here, and moved on from video to static art to 3D, a range of different things. I was in rock bands. I'm coming from Vancouver originally. I'm now in the UK. I got on the ground floor of trying to create some kind of online community in 2000. I was involved in the early days of the New Forms Festival, which was all about curating art and technology, a lot of robotics, different forms of moving image. Exploring different ways to have interactive or new forms of video on the go. I was a researcher on a at the time relatively well-known project that was probably slipped into the archives now, but researchers Tekla Shiphorst and Susan Cozell started a very early art and performance wearable technology project. And I was fortunate to be part of that, their research team. Simultaneously, I was doing a lot of things then as I am now. I was trying to do a master's and exploring before wearable technologies were a thing, but physiological sensing and how to use it in interactive art forms. I came to the UK in 2007. I started my PhD in 2006, and I was trying to explore this idea of embodying technology through initially mobile video before anyone had a mobile video. And then eventually through that was facilitated through the web and connecting people through the web through wearables. So we made some sort of early forms of wearables, not as early as the Whispers project that I mentioned, but still relatively, by today's standards, early days. We used the first generation Arduino and so on. And the idea was to create this online mobile performance. It was a combination of using your mobile phone, your video, and the internet, and being in a live setting. And at the time, it was a really tricky thing to do because not all the technology was there, and I was kind of jumping ahead of what was actually possible. So we made it work. And after I finished my PhD, I went on to work with choreographer Kate Sicchio for many years, and exploring her research was more about sensing and video sensing of the body on stage, and mine was was that idea of sensing the body in a discrete way using garments and bespoke costumes. And so we teamed up together and worked for many years on exploring different ways of working with sensing devices, creating our own sensing devices, and then finding ways to make them interactive between the audience, between the dancers and the audience, between the dancer and the choreographer, between the dancers themselves and the dancers and themselves. And so very much about connecting bodies in different ways over distance. And also hacking was a big part of this project. So it was hacking the data from the body, hacking the garments, hacking as a mode of repurposing and rethinking and remodeling. And as Roberta mentioned, I've also been running this group called E Stitches, which is artists, designers, performers, fashion people, a lot of material scientists, a real mixed group of people trying to think about new ways of exploring textiles and what they tend not to like to call wearables because they don't tend to work in that way, but very much electronic textiles and ways in which we can explore that interface between the body and technology through textiles. I've also been on and off being involved in various forms of performance, either in my own practice or in curation. And this was something during the pandemic that I was involved in, exploring, as many people did, what is online performance. And so I'm jumping straight to this project that's been mentioned and really a new direction for where my work was going, even though my work has always been connected to the body. It became much more personal. And so I started this project in 2019, but it really started before that. So Into Her, I call it Into Her because it's this idea of going inside the body, and it's meant to be an immersive haptic experience that takes people inside the body to explore various, I started calling it post-reproductive, and then I started having these conversations with women and realized it's not post-reproductive, it's just reproductive health, but exploring things that we are only starting to talk about widely, and even then it could be talked about a lot more, things like endometriosis, cancers, of course, and it was based on my own experience. So I had ovarian cancer quite, out of the blue, as it often is, based on just some pains that I was having, not even pain, more like bloating and that kind of thing. Went to the doctor and discovered that I had some kind of cyst that then got treated, and it was very clear that it was cancer, and I had to figure out next steps and how to go about treatment and what to do. And so at the time, of course, I was just caught up in that, and I was caught up in that for a few years. But over time, as I started opening up to people about what was happening to me, I started to hear all kinds of stories from all my female friends and other people I didn't even know about their stories. And initially, I was going to make it about ovarian cancer. And there is a lot of spotlight on that because it's such a deadly form of cancer for women. But I started to expand it out because I learned when I had my surgeries that I'd not only had ovarian cancer, I had endometriosis, I had a fibroid, and I had the whole range that I'm presenting here, I had them all. And so I thought, well, let's open this up because there's so many different stories that women keep to themselves and suffer alone. And this idea of, you know, what we've talked about already about pain being unacknowledged. I started off with a really kind of academic brain on this, and slowly as I brought my team together, I started to feel that I was imposing some sort of intellectual ideas on something that I didn't entirely feel comfortable with. And instead, I turned to two books that really resonated with me, which are not academic books, but were really profound for me at the time. And one is Woman, an Intimate Geography by Natalie Angier, which happened to be on my shelf. I had never looked at it. I have lots of books like that I've collected and somehow forgotten. And when I needed it, it was there. And it's an incredibly detailed prose, visual, visceral kind of exploration of women's bodies from puberty to death. And it became a really important book for my project. And then also a couple of years later, having read Invisible Woman, Exposing Data Bias in a World Designed for Men, Caroline Criado Perez also became that sort of call to arms, like we're not getting enough exposure in the world, and this world is designed for men. And this might be the reason why these things are happening to women not being heard. So I put a team together, primarily women. I've listed mainly the women. There have been a few men who've come on board to help with some bits and pieces, but this was my primary team, all women artists and in different roles. We worked together on these conversations. We weren't just designing together, we were supporting each other because everyone was going through something related. And so we were looking at these ideas of what is female identity, especially when the things that you thought were part of your identity start to slip away. Body image, you know, mortality, feeling betrayed, you know, disease and tumors and these kinds of things, and how they kind of confuse how we see ourselves. And then that these other things around lack of reliable information, this sort of male-dominated medical institutions, even when I saw female doctors, the paradigm is very male-focused. Things around sexuality and feeling that sense of powerless and anger, and of course, isolation and silence. So to answer the question, one of the first questions, and we'll come back to this obviously later, but my work, as I mentioned, comes from this idea of focusing on the body, how we connect out from and return to body through technology, and as a means of extending the senses in the body. I've always been interested in exploring nonverbal communication between performers or between people that are not necessarily performers, but between each other, and how the body is that interface to the world. I've also been thinking about this idea that, or sort of realizing that my focus is also on how to revere the body, how you know, my immediate response to, 90s sort of cyberpunk, and that, and even it still exists in this world of AI and neuroscience, where there's a big focus on how do we replicate the brain and put it into technology. And that's never been my interest. It's been more, how do we use this, our senses, and explore a partnership or that interface with technology, but also to come back to the body and see it as both a fragile site, but also the site of our understanding and experience of the world and our tacit knowing. So I'm always returning to the body. And for this project, I'm trying to acknowledge and address the issue of the lack of understanding of the body. And I'm putting biological bodies because I'm talking about reproductive organs, and then also the poor care for it in the medical system as inferior or lesser or, you know, whatever. So I'm just going to race through some more images because we want to get back to the conversation. But what the project does is it uses the voices of real women telling their stories of their experiences, some more horrific. We start with a story about cervical cancer, and then it moves into some other stories as we move through the journey of the actual reproductive system. And you hear real women's voices and the pain and frustration and that kind of thing as you experience it. And I will also say that this project is not just about the virtual reality dimension of it, which is what it partly is. It's a three-prong kind of experience where I take people into a vagina-shaped tent and make them feel comfortable. And it's a sort of a weird merge of a vagina and a womb. And then give them what I'm calling the haptic corset, which is a belt that they put around their waist between their pubic bone and belly button, which vibrates at different places on the lower abdomen depending on the story that they're hearing. So the VR headset is connected to the belts through Wi-Fi and triggers the different areas where you might feel pain if you were experiencing those diseases or ailments. I based a lot of the work initially on some inspirational installation projects I found out there in the world. The actress Rosaria Dawson made this thing called the Misting Vagina. And you should look it up, because this is just the front side. The back side's really interesting too, and kind of weird and wonderful. It's kind of meant to be the meeting of the vagina and the penis. So the backside is another completely different looking piece. But I was interested in this part. And then this other work by South African artist Reshma Chiba, the walk-in vagina. And I was also, when I was doing my research, I became fascinated by a group I sort of stumbled upon called the Red Tent Movement, which I don't know how big, because I've never gone yet. And I wanted to, it never happened, because I was trying to reach out to them and they seem like they have a specific kind of agenda, and that's fine. Their focus is much more, I think, if I've interpreted it right, is helping young women into understanding their bodies around menstruation and talking about stories of menstruation. So it's an initiation type of experience, which you find in lots of other cultures throughout time. I was also interested in one of the very first books I got as a young woman, the Boston Women's Health Book Collective, called Our Bodies, Ourselves. And, you know, is a tomb, and now it's even bigger, made by women for women, and, you know, meant to help introduce them to their bodies. Quickly, I won't go through this too much, but I was trying to make an experience that actually was based in terms of the storytelling on the body. And so when we were designing it, we kind of explored, how do we do this and how do we put it together? I did some early sketches of haptics. Like Roberta said, I've been involved in some form of wearables for a long time. So I was trying to figure out what is the best way to communicate this sort of visceral dimension. And is it important to have sensing as well as actuation, which is the output, or would it be fine just to have the output? And as it turned out, it was easier for us technologically and financially, because I have to acknowledge I didn't have a lot of money. I did get some from my university. I got some from the Arts Council England, because I'm in the UK. And so we decided with something that was manageable to make, but also it still communicates what we want it to do to communicate. I won't go through a lot of this, but we're also exploring that connection between nature and the body, that we are part of nature. We are nature. And so exploring things like corals and other natural things for the belts. And here's what the outcome, what it looks like. And it takes images from the inside of the VR experience to the outside. And I wanted to make this experience about bringing people in, experiencing it with them, and then talking to them afterwards. So this is a really, really, really rough drawing. I was exploring a new kind of sketching technology. It's very stickman. But we were, the idea here was just to communicate, do something really simple to talk about what is the experiential journey, not just inside the headset, but outside the headset. And so how to help, because I also discovered that somehow my instincts were correct, that you can't just put a headset on somebody and go away. You have to really usher them through the experience in a careful way. And I use that word careful to connect with your topic, but very important to me that people, most of the people who've experienced it have not had any experience with VR before. So I wanted to give them the best experience I could of VR, as well as this sort of more nurturing experience, because it's going to be painful when they're in the emotionally painful to hear the stories of physical pain when they're inside this experience. I had a bespoke tent made for the project, and I initially had this sort of geodesic dome idea in mind, and eventually I thought, no, it needs to be soft. The tissues of the body are soft and fragile. It needs to have that same, you know, instinctively, that was my feeling. I did not initially want to go with pink because it's so stereotyped. But when I looked at the color, the alternate color, which was this of what would be closer to what our bodies actually look like, it was kind of orangey, kind of brown. I didn't like it aesthetically. I thought it was not for me. I didn't want it to look like chicken. So I just chose not to do that. So this is what we've got. And these are some images from different places I've exhibited it so far. And I've been in a parking garage, in a food for the community space, and in a shopping mall. And so in some really interesting, weird spaces. I've been exhibiting it since last summer, although we were kind of still in COVID, so it was very restricted amounts of exhibition opportunities. And most recently, it was in Brighton Digital in November, as well as Neon Arts Festival in Scotland. And then I went to visit briefly in the OCAD Game Lab, and Roberta was there also to support a talk at that time. So that was in December. And I may have not have written this right about where we're exhibiting next, Roberta, so I'll correct that when the time comes. Some other images of the inside of the project and some of the tech. I wanted to show this picture because I thought it was so chaotic. This is all the headsets displayed in the parking garage in Brighton for Brighton Digital. They didn't have any tables for me. They didn't have anything to make display it. It wasn't meant to be for display, but it was definitely meant to be semi-secure. And you can see how chaotic and it was a bit crazy. I have a million, it's exaggeration, but I have so many pictures of inside the tent, but I don't know why, but it always seems to be really captivating for people to take pictures. And as well, I just really like seeing different people and their experience inside the space. There's been so many different kinds of people. And then I was, for Brighton Digital, they took some pictures, and this was one of me coming out. I had somebody do a drawing of it, which looks like half like a vagina, half like a beehive. I was in the Courier and they took this other picture, so I thought I'd share those. Oh, this is playing. I have a book I've been collecting feedback as you do, but I've been really heartened and surprised actually about how positive I know it sounds weird, but how positive the feedback has been where I thought there would be, you know, there's always going to be somebody who doesn't like it and doesn't have a good experience, but I haven't really had that experience so far. I've had people say, oh, the garment should be, you know, the vibration should be stronger, especially men. Say, oh, I want to really feel like it, what it feels like for women. I was like, do you? And then there's, then it often really triggers a lot of other stuff and people want to share that stuff. And that for them makes it powerful and important for them because it gave them permission to feel things and talk about things they wouldn't necessarily do. So I had one gynecologist daughter said, oh, you know, that's not exactly positioned right. But by and large, all the feedback has been really, really good. And I was lucky enough to be shortlisted for the Lumen Prize this year, and which was actually quite miraculous because they didn't get to see the full experience. They didn't get to go into the tent. They didn't get the haptic belt. They just saw the VR side of it. So I felt like, oh, they only got a third of the experience and they thought it was good. So that was also really rewarding. I had no idea what was going to happen when I first did this. I just wanted to do it and needed to do it. So it's been really amazing to get all the great support. And I can show a trailer, but I know we're pressed for time, so I can also save that till later on. Thoughts?
We can save it until okay. until later.
Sure.
This is all incredibly. I'm particularly taken by this idea of sort of extending the sensing body in a direction of really valorizing the senses as opposed to the kind of major sort of dominant interest in artificial intelligence, which is in fact exclusively at the behest of the brain, sort of that dematerialization that tends to happen. And this kind of way of bringing the interface front and center with regards to haptic ideas and that as a way, as a particular way of knowing, I find particularly crucial. I'm going to ask you to stop. Thank you. This is wonderful. I think we're going to kind of hold on to questions or further comments until after Alanna presents her work and shows what her approach to these issues. Alanna Kibbe is a multimedia artist and writer based in Toronto, Ontario. She's actually an old friend from, we are both mothers and share children's who have somewhat grown up together or have only recently diverged paths. Alanna began her current era of creative work after her body retired her from midwifery. And this is actually when I first met you, so you were still a midwife. The body moved her from a world governed by birth into a world of making magic and art as medicine. A fears Pierce disability justice advocate, Alanna's work centers healing and transformation in both her artistic processes and her work's presentation as rooted in community. Her work is marked by lived resilience, passionate survival, and the transition from sickness to beauty in imperfection. Her practices of meditation, martial arts, and journaling to vision the future are interwoven into her creative processes. She's also a mother, as I just mentioned, a gardener and an herbal medicine maker, and a lover of community building and community care. So thank you so much, Alanna, for agreeing to be part of the speaker series on all of the exhibition.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for that lovely introduction. I'm thrilled to be here. I don't have a presentation that's quite like Camille's. That was incredible. But I'm good at talking. So hopefully I'll take you all with me. It's very interesting. I was listening to Camille's talk and just seeing how many overlapping factors there are in coming to this place of creating creative work from a place specifically of healing through illnesses that are specific to women. And my story is a little bit different. I made art as a young person, as an expression, a form of expression, as a form of communication. But it wasn't my priority in my life, I would say, until I started getting sick. I started engaging in work related to wellness, female health, reproductive health, and gendered issues when I was very, very young. My high school at age 15 gave me gym credits for volunteering at an abortion clinic as a runner. I was in America and they needed someone who was fast to meet the bus at the bus stop and run people through the protesters onto the property. And that sort of reproductive activism was what led me into becoming a midwife. After volunteering at a couple of different clinics and then working in an abortion facility in Florida, I couldn't stomach how little I was able to do to transform the ways that autonomy in birth is completely disengaged from birth in the healthcare system. And so my work as a midwife and my work in reproductive health and reproductive justice has always been rooted in the growing of community. And I think that working in that world, very interestingly, gave me the tools that guided me through what it looked like to be a sick person, to be unwell, to at certain points feel like a full-time patient. It gave me the tools to communicate with my care providers through challenges like brain fog and you know, having a hard time thinking and formulating, but I still knew their language, just as an example. So really I went from this world of birth. I delivered many hundreds of babies over a 15-year period. Many of them at home, at birth centers, rooted in community, rooted in family. And I went from that to being faced all the time with my own mortality. I didn't start that process with cancer. I started with autoimmune disease. And just as I was starting to heal from that autoimmune disease, I was in a pretty rough car accident that made it very difficult to heal in the context of the autoimmune disease. And I then was diagnosed with breast cancer and went through breast cancer concussed from this car accident. And so my story is a story very much where the cancer time that I experienced felt like what Teva Harrison refers to as the in-between. I didn't feel like I could be present because what was present? What was happening in my body? I was still trying to learn that. I was going through testing and bouncing from clinicians and specialists and what my trajectory for my future looked like was literally within the underworld of the in-betweens. From a spiritual perspective, it was a time where I had to go very internally to learn how to build resilience within myself to walk through healthcare practices and processes. And so the intersection of working with birth and my own mortality is really where my work is born. It's where my work comes from. But it's very rooted still in community care and interdependence. And so my work is, and I'll mention this a couple of times, it's very intentionally work that's meant to be shared with the public. I'm not creating work for a purpose of profit in any way. I'm creating it for the purpose of the stories that I'm telling. I'm creating it for the purpose of communicating not just my own story to center myself, but more a centering of we have these beautiful stories of how we heal and how we survive and how we discover our own resilience, that when we share them in a community context can help grow community resilience and give inspiration to one's own creative practices. My work also very much comes from my meditation practice. I spend a lot of time in bed. I had breast cancer in 2018, healing from that gifted me something called lymphedema, where my lymphatic system doesn't flush the lymphatic fluid properly because of the lymph nodes that were removed in surgery. And the combination of that and the spinal disease that I have and injuries from the car accident, prolonged concussion symptoms, had led me to start living a very different life. Sometimes bedridden, sometimes stuck on one floor of my house because the work of going up and down the stairs is too intense. And from that, I started painting in the corner of my bedroom. I used Frida Kahlo's story as an inspiration, and I literally started painting in my bed. And at the same time, I was developing my meditation practice, because who the hell can stay calm during things like this? And my meditation practice started gifting me visions of paintings that represented components of the healing processes that I was experiencing. My meditation practice started gifting me tools for feeling like I was thriving in a very different way that I could express through my creative work. One of those pieces is this. During the winter of 2020, while we were cooped up in the pandemic, I'm trying to not have it reflect, I started painting flowers. I was cooped up, I was in the house, it was the pandemic. My body felt like a catastrophe. And so I painted gardens and gardens and gardens because I needed to feel like I was in the middle of a garden. And how else could I do that but just by painting it and making it be what I was surrounded by? And so that way of creating the existence that creates thriving and healing from a sort of future hopefulness perspective is very embedded in my work. And it actually helps me continue to vision new work. It addresses different versions of care, primarily the care that we contain for ourselves. And I don't mean self-care in a sort of common understanding. I don't mean bubble baths and face masks. I mean the care we give ourselves when we must go internal into the hardest parts of ourselves, where we have to sit face to face with our mortality and offer it tea. I'm talking about the ways wherein we feel transformation occurring as we're healing, but we aren't yet transformed. those spaces are part of what I'm capturing through the time that I spend at rest and in my visioning processes. And the other sort of version of care that I'm attempting to capture is the intertwined ways of healing that are directly rooted in the growing of community. I don't know how I would possibly be thriving in any area of my life without the different components of community that I have grown through interconnectedness, through through interconnected resiliencies, whether it's what I call my cancer friends, or whether it is folks in the disability justice community. Those different versions of community are part of the care that actually help me heal. And a beautiful, beautiful way of healing that's actually come out of that is that through sharing my cancer story and the art that I'm making as I'm coming through healing from it, on my social media networks, I have been contacted so many times by women who I didn't know, who were living through breast cancer in different stages, but mostly the very early in-between stages, who were put in touch with me by other people who saw me telling my story. It's happened so many times, I feel like I'm running a peer support network. It's close to 24 at this point, I think. And it just looks like a dynamic, vulnerable exchange of here's where I am and here's what it looks like when my breasts were taken from my body and here's how I've healed from that. And let's talk about exercises and let's talk about the deep, deep presumptions that are embedded in the healthcare system and how to thrive through those. And I think that work is part of the fuel for my work. Giving that care gives me care to create the work I'm creating. There's a very dynamic community component that exists there. And it's almost like I talked with recently another friend who's an artist in the disability justice community. It's like a community web of healing where we're sort of stuck together in our own resilience with other people's resilience and the care that gets sort of flowed between us in a balance. I don't quite know how I would ever thrive in any way without that. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the challenges that I have experienced in the healthcare system as a patient, and how I've addressed them a little bit creatively and through my work directly. Maneuvering through my own knowledge of myself and my knowledge of the healthcare system that's informed by having worked in it for over 15 years has been a dynamic balancing act that has involved figuring out how to navigate carefully with attention to all of the moving parts to try to get what I need as my own best knowledge keeper. As patients, we aren't necessarily viewed as our best knowledge keeper. We are viewed sometimes as numbers. We are viewed as dynamic data to be taken into account in only selective contexts. But we are not viewed as our own specialists of ourself. And I walked through my care very carefully, carrying that with me and making sure that it became a part of my story, not just within me, but for my healthcare providers as well. So some of the different ways that that looked like navigating, specifically in terms of protocols, I love this question, included that after I had imaging done, I'll go back even further, actually. The first imaging that was recommended after I found a lump in my breast that had not been there a couple months beforehand, and that was hard and of concern as a clinician who knew how to examine breasts prior to that, I had the recommendation of having a mammogram. That was the first sort of step. And my response at that time was to say, well, I'm young. I'm only 40 years old and I'm premenopausal. And I had the knowledge to be able to name. I understand that for many premenopausal women, the tissue has a higher density and mammogram may not be the best imaging. Things like that were very, very important components of knowledge keeping that helped me navigate through my care with wellness. So for example, ultimately ultrasound was what was able to view the cancer that was in my body and my mammogram was normal. That was with every version of advanced imaging in mammogram that was possible. And when I think about that, I think, what would this have looked like if I hadn't known that premenopausal women can potentially have higher density breast tissues? What would this have looked like if I hadn't had that knowledge for my own advocacy? At one point I had imaging done where I was told, oh, you're breastfeeding. And I said, no, not for years. And what they were seeing in my ducts was actually cancer. And they made a presumption because of my age, because of how young I was, that what they were seeing was related to lactation. I hadn't lactated for over 3 years. And so a lot of things like that came up. And as those first things were coming up, I realized I really needed to make my care dynamic to be able to not just be a number. And as I did that, I started creating dynamic ideas about healing that really changed the way being a cancer patient felt. I brought cake to my first surgical consult for everyone in the office. I doubt they ate it. I didn't have a Tupperware. I put it in like a plastic bag and it was probably mushy because I made it vegan and gluten-free and eggless and all the things. I figure if they have allergies, they can still eat it. And I brought that. I just wanted to be the patient who brought the cake instead of just the patient. Right. And some of those dynamics really carried me through. And some of them, I had to even go beyond into deeper creativity. And that was where my healing started to feel exciting. And even though I was still in the thick of it and challenged by the recent loss of my breasts and the dynamic composure of my body, learning how to move my arms again and my making my muscles work and all of these things, I had to continue propelling myself forward. And I did that creatively. So when I found out that the cancer centers in my entire geographic region had all canceled their body image after breast cancer classes, courses, and workshops, I went and I took a burlesque class, and I looked for the dynamic movement, next possible thing that could put me back into my body. and make me feel alive in that space again. And that is also quite a bit of where my work comes from. The addressing of the presumptions, the walking through surgical consults and clinicians repeatedly needing to explain and express, no, I don't want another version of breasts to be put on my body. And the dynamic communication of saying, you know what, they have to go so that I can be in wellness, and I don't need something else to replace that now. I'm quite content with what I am. I'm quite content with my own skin. Scars are just as beautiful as whatever you could possibly try to create on me. And I think that there started being an exchange that happened where I was teaching my clinicians about welcoming whatever it is that a patient might show up with. And I attempt to address that in my work. So one of the pieces that's in the show that's just been hung and is opening on the 31st is a piece called Renewal. And it is a dynamic piece looking at the context of the bra and prosthetic culture in the sense of sort of viewing it as a bit of a costume and the shedding of it. And so I reconstructed a bra with prosthetics adhered into it using snake sheds and snake skin and in representation of that shedding, that transformation, that release, and that letting go of those expectations specifically that loved ones, healthcare systems, clinicians all have of what creates a new normal after illness, particularly in a woman's body. I can't quite wrap my head around the idea of clinicians assuming that there are certain versions of reconstructing normal that should happen in other contexts outside of a reproductive context. This is what is determined as routine, sexualized, appropriate, feminine, et cetera. So this is what must exist. And I challenge that in both my work and my life, my lived experience of choosing not to have reconstruction and not to wear prosthetic breasts. And so in my work, I'm calling healing back in. I'm calling in those vulnerable processes of purging what's expected and calling them into a state of transformation. One of the ways that I have chosen to do that in a context of community care centers around my piece that is interactive called Where Breasts Become Stardust. And that piece really calls in interdependence as a form of transformational healing. The piece is a treasure map that looks at the geographic travels of my breasts after they left my body. I contacted and deeply researched, contacted the pathology department where they were removed from my body and researched their sort of vacation trajectory after that, from the leaving of my body and the to the basement pathology department, to their going to an incineration plant where they were incinerated in a machine called the Joy 2000. And then they went off to have a party at another incineration plant that's called the Emerald City, which of course makes me think of the Wizard of Oz. And then from there, they journeyed to Niagara Falls, where they literally became so finally incinerated that all they were was dust, which I reimagined and re-envisioned as the re-becoming of stardust, the re-gifting of that part of my body that was no longer necessary for my thriving and survival, back into the stardust, back into the universe, to become something else, to become part of the galaxies that surround us, to become part of the ether. And in that visioning, I called in assistance. And what that looks like is an ask for participation of anyone viewing the work to consider writing their own story of becoming stardust, or their own visioning of how of prayers that my breasts need to become the ether, or whatever that might look like. And I then progressively, as a durational component of the work, weave those writings, those well wishes, those dreams into the piece itself. The piece itself is constructed of 9 canvases that are put together with rebar, with weaving of textiles between the rebar that's made of fabrics from a breast cancer event that I attended, and depictions of Frida Kahlo, and tape from VHS movies of Bruce Lee fighting. And I wove them all together in a dynamic storytelling of its own, given the history of textile art. And throughout the showing of the piece, weave those other pieces into the weaving itself. This is actually one of the most dynamic expressions of the ways that I calibrate my creative processes. It centers the illness experience through visual storytelling and through community care at the same time. And really, that's the intention with my work, is calling in the dynamic interface of those different components. The disability justice framework that's embedded in all of my work is critical to the work, and critical to the sharing of the work, because without that framework, I logistically could not share the work. So, for example, this particular exhibition has a backbone of over a dozen different people who have assisted me in my home studio, who have assisted me with my food preparation, who have assisted me with my children's and home care, so that I could logistically share this work in this exhibition. And that doesn't even include the teams at U of T and York University who have come together to help facilitate the logistical processes. So that dynamic of community care is a necessity to my work in every capacity. I think I've talked enough. I'm going to stop myself here. But I think I've carried through sort of where I've come from and where I am. I guess I'll just say that the disability justice dynamic, it gives me permission to challenge my internal ableism in my work and how I share it and how I produce it in a way that's necessary for its existence. In the entire year 2020, I believe I completed 3 works, though only one of them was really done in that year. In 2021, I think I completed 1 piece. Because I went through many, many, many months with fibromyalgia-induced pain in my hands, and I couldn't hold paintbrushes. But during that time, I journaled and I dreamed up 1,000 new ideas. And so that dynamic of allowing is just critical. And I would just, before I close, I just want to say thank you to all of the people who are here today and who might be watching, who have been a part of supporting that allowing that helps me create my work.
Thank you so much. And amazing. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I'm going to ask Shalika to bring up both Roberta and Camille and Alanna together, so that we can sort of all be in place and start a conversation. We do have a good 35 minutes available, so there is a lot of there's good time to converse. And by listening to both of you, one thing that to me that stuck with me, and there was something that Alanna said while she was presenting that I think I'm curious to ask Camille about, and whether the project Camille is engaged in might have that direction to it too. At one point, Alanna said that through the journey of sort of navigating the healthcare system, she found herself by centering the self, so teaching the clinician, teaching your clinician to listen to however a patient may show up, to whatever might come up. And I do think that and the cake bringing is a way to kind of move away from that, those to defamiliarize the deep assumptions around, you know, what are those the rituals of the role of patient doctor that typically kind of puts you in the position of the docile compliant person who does everything that's been asked for without any sense of agency, without that recognition that there is that deep knowledge that you have of your own body, of what's happening to you. And so I'm curious, Camille, as to, because I see also the way you're centering the stories I had the privilege of listening to the stories and experiencing at OCAD this past December, your piece, the centering of that, you know, being one's own best knowledge keeper and how that then can actually transfer or translate or be proposed or be articulated in relation to healthcare teams. Because I do find that and Alanna's talk was instructive in that sense, that healthcare professionals are, it's well-intentioned, and yet they don't know better because the education itself or the sensibility that it's cultivated professionally does not allow that openness, continues to cultivate a certain narrow-mindedness. So I'm wondering about sort of how your work might contribute to that, Camille. And as I already see kind of, yeah, I'll leave it.
Well, so I didn't talk so much about my journey in the healthcare system, but I have to say some of what Alanna said resonated. Other things came up for me that were kind of different. And I'm here in the UK, the system is different. I would say on the one hand, I was incredibly lucky because I had a very, very early stage ovarian cancer and they didn't even understand how I even caught it. So somehow that intuitive tacit knowledge was there that there was something not right. And I was treated with this is important, we need to do something. So I was quite, I felt on that one hand very lucky. I went to a local GP that was a woman. She was like, this doesn't feel right. You need to have initially several ultrasounds and then a CT scan. Then we don't know what it is. We think it's possibly cancerous, but we're not sure. So the only way that we know how to get in there with the ovary is to take it out. And that, so, and my very first encounter with a gynecologist was, I felt negative. And I insist, I've always insisted on seeing female doctors if I can, because I've had very early on, I had very creepy, weird experiences with male doctors. And I said, not, that's the first point of like taking your healthcare in your own hands, is deciding who is going to touch me and who's not. But even so, we were talking about this traditional ideas, or these very, what I think are misogynist on some level, but maybe not, maybe I'm overreacting, but at least very patriarchal, was female gynecologist saying to me, you've had your children, right? You're not going to have any more children. Why don't you just take it all out? And I immediately recoiled, feeling like, would if someone said there's something going on with you, why don't we just take it all out? I mean, I don't know how other people respond, but what I did discover on my journey was that a lot of women do just do what they're told, and I'm just not that person. And I said, that shouldn't matter. Why are we so caught up in the idea that these organs have only one purpose? Because I'm a very sexual being. I want to be able to experience sexual euphoria. And I've read plenty about the role of these organs is misunderstood or not well understood, that it's only about reproduction and does have no other functions. And I don't believe that. So that was my first feeling, is that all they care about is A, that it's going to, you know, that it's troublesome, so let's get rid of it. And why don't we get rid of everything? Because you don't need it anymore anyway. And I really recoiled also because I recalled a story from my grandmother that she went in to get, and this is obviously in like this, I don't know when, 60s or something, that she went in to get her appendix removed and they gave her a hysterectomy. And so my automatic response was, please don't offer me this fairly old-fashioned response to something that I think could be quite nuanced. So I when I did finally agree, I went to somebody else and I finally agreed to get the ovary removed. I was really of the mind that all my body matters and I want to keep as much of it as I can because it's mine. And I don't know what it's capable of. I don't know entirely all the different things that it does, but I want to be able to have that opportunity to experience it. So when I did finally get rid of the tumor, and they found out that it was a tumor, and it was quite dramatic, brought my partner and his daughter, and they announced that it was cancer, and you know, I burst into tears. It took me a while to recover from that and think, okay, so what is the next move? Because they're recommending that I go and again rip it all out and then we'll be done with it. And I again didn't feel that that was the right course of action. I wanted to figure out what my options were. And I spent a lot of time researching without the help of the medical profession, partly because I didn't feel what they gave me was enough. I didn't get enough answers. I went to three different oncologists, one privately, and another one was just a second opinion. But I really felt like their response was, well, you know, we don't know enough about cancer, so we're just going to, one woman actually said this, was, our response to cancer is it's like a mouse in a warehouse and we're just going to bomb the whole thing. And I was like, are you kidding me? That's not the response anyone wants to hear, but, you know, surely you have more sophisticated tools than that. And so I luckily at that one of these meetings, I brought a friend with me and she asked a lot of questions that I wasn't quite ready or had the objectivity to ask about things that I could ask for, I suppose. But for my biggest revelation was actually when I finally, it took me much longer than they wanted me to. They wanted me to immediately go back, right back into surgery and take whatever they could out. I waited, I wanted to research, I wanted to figure out what was the best option. Should I lose my uterus or should I, you know, keep it? Should I, you know, am I getting rid of the whole other ovary? Do I need to get rid of the other ovary? What are the chances of getting cancer in that one? And so I spent months trying to figure it out until I, with no help, with what I felt was really no help, partly because I was told I had a rare form, and many women my age, you know, most women get ovarian cancer after 65, and I was in my 40s. So, you know, that the chances of that are very rare to start with. And then on top of that, most of the women who don't get the surgery want to have children. They're even younger. And the possibility of it, move the cancer moving into the other ovary, all I could find was a few, very few reports that said there's a 30% chance you could get it again. And that was a weird gamble, because like 30% is not too much, but 30% is not nothing. How do you decide? So, and I just felt like nobody helps you make those decisions. I couldn't really call, you know, every time I had a conversation with the oncologist, it was like, well, whatever you want to do. And I was like, well, I don't know what to do. Why don't you tell me? And they were like, well, what do you want to know? And I don't know what I want to know. So there was like this, I felt like it was just a dance where they wouldn't tell me anything beyond what I asked. They didn't actually give me preventative information or decision-making information or any of these kinds of things, or even these research studies that I could study. I had to find them myself. So I felt like on the one hand, I was lucky I had people jump in there and work on the problem right away. But on the other hand, they gave me almost no information and I had to dig it up and find it and make decisions pretty much on my own. And then when I had the second surgery where they took my other ovary, I asked to keep my uterus in the long run. And even then I couldn't decide. I ended up seeing a hormone specialist who told me if I did get rid of the cancer, a lot of things would happen if I had surgical menopause that would be quite dangerous, you know, to my body. And I would want to think about taking hormone replacement if I could. And so that was another thing. Like they kept saying, no, you can't have hormone replacement. It's a hormone sensitive cancer. And then finally, the hormone specialist asked me to ask them, if you've got the cancer, why can't I have this hormone replacement therapy? And so I decided, again, she was the only one who helped me make any kind of decision, and she's private. I decided that I would keep my uterus, get rid of my other ovary, keep my cervix, keep everything except my other ovary. They had to take some omentum and lymph nodes to see if it spread. They decided to take my appendix because they said that cancer lives there. So I did go through another surgery, and it was coming out of that surgery where I was on a ward with a lot of different women. Two had already had full hysterectomies, like full hysterectomy. I had like laparoscopic surgery. They had the whole, I want to say, zipper surgery where they just open everything out. And so they had to stay in the hospital for 5 days, and I just was there for 18. But I listened to what was the conversations. I asked them questions. One woman is pretty much dying of ovarian cancer. Another woman had been told she needed to get her uterus or hysterectomy because she had a fibroid, and she didn't question whether she should do that or not. She just said, the doctor told me to do it, so I did it. And so I asked her questions like, so have they talked about what happens next? And for me, that was the number one question that nobody talked about. What happens next? There's a presumption that you're going to die or you're going to be okay, and neither of their problem. And I really wanted to know what's going to happen after. Like, looks like I'm going to live. Looks like I'm going to get through this. So what about after? And is only the hormone specialist who actually talked about after. And I felt like, to me, that was the number one thing that, amongst all the other things that I'd encountered, where they didn't give you any nuanced, you know, options. There was very little information. But the other piece about not caring about what happens next is like, oh, that's somebody else's problem, or that's your problem. I'm not going to be there for that. I'm only here for this bit. And this sort of really segmented approach to healthcare where one passes you on to the next, on to the next, and there's no joined up, no holistic approach was really what bothered me. And this other idea of a lot of women just doing what they're told. Now, I also talked to a ovarian cancer charity nurse who told me, especially in the UK and especially with much older women, there is a fear of taking going to the doctor. And this is one of the reasons why ovarian cancer kills, because it's very silent. And then when it gets to the point where it's painful, it's already too late. And a lot of older women are more uncomfortable going to the doctor. She also said North American and French women are more likely to take their own health into their own hands. But to me, that seemed like a really important piece, that women need to feel comfortable talking about their own bodies and also taking their healthcare into their own hands and asking questions. And that's what motivated me to do this project, as I felt like I'm an artist. What can I do? I can do a conversation piece where we have a conversation about why are you not being taken seriously? What are you experiencing? And why aren't you fucking mad? Excuse my language, but why are you not mad about it? And trying to get them to listen to you. And maybe they are. In a lot of cases, a lot of the women I talk to are really mad, but maybe I feel like on some level, I want it to be more mad and more, more something more. We all need to get together more and do more for ourselves, because a lot of the time they're not doing it. I don't know if I answered your question, but
No, definitely. I'm wondering if Roberta has anything to say, or if Alanna wants to follow up, or if there's anyone from the audience too.
I actually want to say something, because when I was listening to both of you speaking, and also like the last sentence that Camille said, we need to get together more. This is actually quite the core of what both of you said, and I'm brought back to thinking about this getting together more as like a big matter of relationality, like how everything that, like, whatever we do to empower ourselves has to be in relation to something else, or in relation to other women, or in relation to the caregiver, or in relation to the world around us. And then I was thinking about the type of work that you're doing, and the fact that you are advocating your work, the turning into like turning care into a community act. Everything is in as with the community for various reasons, and it can be like to provide a support that is emotional, because women talk to women to have each other's back, basically. For mentorship, because other women need information. I mean, in both cases, your journey is very much out there, and I really hope that everybody will come to the exhibitions. But it's very much out there, and this is this provides emotional support, but also information for other women and for other people who need it. And so that for with that comes also some awareness, and there's also like some creative tactics that are embedded into it, because the more I speak with you, the more I hear stories. Like I'm very taken by that story of Alanna going to the doctor with the cake, for example. This is a way to humanize the practice itself. So I think that like this with this dialogue, maybe what we are aiming at is not so much talking about like single stories or single artworks, but like talking about the wider picture that is like turning care into more of a relational type of network, really. So I'm wondering if you, like, I'm sure you have something to say, both of you, but I'm just putting the seed there because I think that this is the right direction to go.
I would love to speak to that. I love this idea of the interrelationality of care. Shortly after I was diagnosed with breast cancer, some of my neighbors were having a wine night. It was actually, I think, an Easter something preparation, but it actually just meant the women were mostly the women were sitting around drinking wine, and there might have been something about Easter. And everyone knew that I had recently been diagnosed with breast cancer. And the more wine we drank, the more we were talking about it sort of openly. And one of the women stood up and put her hands on her hips and said, "I'd like to know what cancer feels like." And the next thing I knew, everyone in the room had lined up to feel me up and feel what a tumor feels like. And that dynamic community-based communication of health knowledge felt so, so deeply important in that moment. This group of women, all about my age, all mothers like I was, with young children about my children's ages, took their own fear of their lack of knowledge and learned about what cancer felt like just for a moment, so that they could empower themselves a little bit differently in their own bodies. And that was just extraordinary. And let me tell you, it was a very different world from what was called peer support in the hospitals. Do you know what I mean? It was a real life connection-based organic event. And it was so different from the peer support of, I'm telling my story and now I'm inaccessible, right? That distance that exists between everything in the healthcare system makes us feel alone while we're walking through it. And the humanizing of our own story within the system, I actually think changes the system. I think that it creates a dynamic of change or change potential, at least, for the healthcare providers who are engaged with it. It's a new way of approaching things. And I love that. I love that idea that when I tell people that I had breast cancer at 40 and I had both of my breasts removed in mastectomy, or if I'm really feeling bold that day, I'll call it amputation, which is what it is. I get this response so often of, "Oh, I'm so sorry," or, "Oh, that sounds hard." But what I don't get the response of is, "Wow, look at how you're thriving. Wow, look at the community that you've created. Oh my gosh, your cancer has given birth to your art." There's a before and an after cancer that exists once you've lived through this. And the after has so much potential because you've looked at mortality and then you've gotten past mortality into being alive. And that aliveness can't be contained within a single human. We have to share it with each other, or what the hell is it good for? So I love this topic because I love ideas that contain potential of change. Thank you for that, Roberta.
Yeah, on that note, I wanted to just say something that I found very important about your work, Alanna, that I think needs to be sort of also highlighted, is that the question of within this this idea of care as transformation, like that in fact that there is transformation, that the idea of cure kind of recedes in favor of and the idea of actually putting healing as anchored to the idea of cure. Healing does not necessarily mean cure, or does not necessarily kind of returning to normal. There is this unanticipated transformation, and at the core is, you know, what do you do with that transformation? How do you move into that transformation? There's something you said at the very beginning of your talk around something about, you know, the moment you got the diagnosis, that, you know, you sensed, and through meditation, you sensed the transformation happening, but you didn't quite know where it was going to take you. But that's where the full sense of the healing, like in non, we are wedded to given already ideas of what to expect as already given outcomes, as opposed to something that's more open-ended, and that requires, in fact, a different kind of attention to exactly how a body becomes, even through those amputating interventions that are, and the violence of those interventions. I see there is a hand up by Lisa, and I'm just going directly to Lisa because I'm...
Well, there's Lisa, and then there's a question from Dolores, so like we should take both.
Okay.
I'll articulate mine. And then, yes, I'm actually very much looking forward to Dolores's and maybe Eva's if I see this. So articulating mine, there's a couple of things I wanted to bring together because I did have the delight of experiencing the piece in December. And one of the things that experientially the girdle created for me was, I want to come back to what you said, Alanna, about the re-education, I guess, art as a re-education. And so there was both the estrangement of the normative body and the articulation of it, that knowledge in a social way, because the girdle both, sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. It didn't articulate as this is what it feels like, coming back to your moment, Alanna, of like the man who wanted to, Camille said, what does it feel like? And Alanna, your moment of friends saying, what does cancer feel like? And so there's this both estrangement and rearticulation of feeling and education of feeling, and it's articulated socially. So that's something that I really enjoyed about it. But I want to be short because I want to hear you answer Dolores's question as well. Thank you.
I think I'll read Dolores's question. She writes, this is a question for both of you. How do you think you would have approached these issues if you would have been of an older age? Would women in their 70s or 80s would get even less attention, you'd think, as their after may be shorter in the system's view?
Can I just start with that? Because like I said, when I was in the hospital with older women, I did get that sense that there was a different sense of their bodies. I'm not sure that they would be considered lesser. I guess there is something about a generational difference in terms of how we think about our bodies, how we have been socialized, I would say, at least I was, to be slightly more comfortable with our bodies. I don't think everybody all the time is comfortable with their bodies. I did have some interesting experiences when I was in Brighton, where there was young women, 18, 19, who said things like, thank you for telling me about my body because nobody else is, which kind of broke my heart actually. But I feel like I grew up in a time when things were slightly more open, and I see, you know, the older generation less comfortable, less able to speak up about their bodies. And when I had these conversations with these ovarian cancer nurses who worked primarily with women in their 60s, 70s, 80s who'd had ovarian cancer, they said they were often very uncomfortable with their bodies. And this is one of the reasons why they didn't feel comfortable even going to the doctor, even talking to receptionists at the doctor's office about something going on. So I do feel that there is a generational difference. I think, and I hope that the even younger generation are even more in tune with themselves, I would hope. But I mean, like I said, I ran into some teenagers who didn't fill me with great hope. But yeah, so I think there are generational differences. Let me just find that chat and see if I've actually addressed that. I think that point about getting less attention is interesting, because I think we do start to treat, you know, this whole idea that after you're, you know, women who are newsreaders or who are actors find it harder and harder to be paid attention to and to be given any, like, you're past your prime, you've gone through menopause, you no longer mean anything or matter. So I think there might be something to that more culturally, and hopefully we're starting to move past that, as well as, like I say, my generation and many of you are in the same age group are now going through menopause and are now trying to make the conversation open about what's happening to our bodies. That would be my answer.
Mm-hmm. My answer is going to be a little bit different, because a younger presenting woman with breast cancer is actually treated a little bit differently, in the sense that there's an automatic presumption that the priority in care is to maintain the breasts, keep them at any cost. And so I had to go through explaining, I'll be honest, I started every one of my clinical meetings with a new clinician, with my tattoos covered, with presenting myself as a midwife. I'm now a retired midwife, but at the time I was still a registered midwife. I wanted them to look at me and see a peer. I wanted them to understand that I had a context for the research behind my decision-making, because I knew that would help me be believed. The automatic assumption that it was more important for me to keep my breasts than for me to live best, longest, thriving, was stunning to me. And so I needed to see three different physicians before it was understood that I was going to have a complete bilateral mastectomy, not complete as in depth with the nodes, there's, just to be clear medically, but complete as in both of my breasts would be removed, that I was not interested in attempting to have chemo first just to preserve some of my breast tissue, that I was not interested in having a more minimal surgery that would then require imaging every 6 months for the rest of my life and radiation. I wanted the least intervention and the longest life. And what I look like, I will figure out how to make it be exactly who I am. And that way of being felt very foreign in the responses that I got from healthcare providers. I literally walked into my first appointment saying, you know, I'm going to be having bilateral mastectomy. I'm not interested in breast conservation surgery. I was speaking their language. I'd done my research. I put it all on the table, and still I needed to see multiple physicians and explain, no, I'm really sure. I don't need to try to keep them. I'd rather be alive longer. Right. And I don't know that approach and context would be taken with someone who's 75 or 80. I don't know, because most of the people who I met as a breast cancer patient were also younger, and that was intentional because that world is geared toward the expectation of aging patients. And so I surrounded myself with non-aging patients so that I could feel not alone, so that I could have peers to identify with, so that I could, feel a little bit less marginalized in the world by being 40 and having breast cancer. It's a very interesting dynamic to think about. I think that, the idea of breast conservation surgeries as a priority has really been, I mean, this gets into the politics of it, but it's really a part of the way that plastic surgery is incorporated into cancer care. And breast conservation surgeries and reconstruction are so incorporated into cancer care from the perspective of the maintaining of the appearance of a breast that plastics wouldn't even be involved in my care in deciding not to do complex reconstruction of a breast tissue. So in other words, when I requested to have the type of surgery that is called flat closure or flat surgical closure. And I said, I'd really like to have plastics involved to make sure I have beautiful scars. I have tattoos all over my chest. I would like them put back together. I'd like to look this particular way of put together in my skin, in my scars. And I was told no, plastics aren't involved unless you're building new breasts onto your body. And this is a realm in breast cancer care, specifically for younger women, that is very, very challenging, because there is actually an epidemic of disbelieving women that they don't want reconstruction. And it has resulted in women having surgeries done where they have extra tissue and skin left on their entire upper torso breast region, with the assumption that someday they'll change their mind and they'll want reconstruction. And I was very fortunate that I had an incredible surgeon who, in the absence of plastics being involved with my care, I know we're running out of time, but I just want to finish the story quickly. In the absence of plastics being a part of my care, this surgeon took on a personal interest in my case because it just so happened that I had delivered her godchild as a midwife. And she then, because of that interconnectedness in the world of me having been the midwife at that birth, took on greater responsibility than was indicated by the healthcare system or her job to help repair me in a way that felt beautiful to me. Mm-hmm. And that says so much about the healthcare system and how it functions and how it attends to patients' humanness as a system.
Yeah.
And I do have permission to share that story.
Yeah, that's good.
I had to ask because it involves a birth, right? Yes.
So, Alanna, there's another question. Actually, it's coming from YouTube, but the person knows me and she sent me a message.
Go ahead.
And I just wanted to because I think it's actually very very good to share. She said, I don't know how to send question comments on YouTube, so she sent it to me. She's this is from Natalie. I had a kidney cancer, and yes, there is an after. It has been as a sign of my impermanence, and I have to live the life I want now. It's the life I want now. It's strange, but cancer gives me a strong feeling of life and a terrific sensation of death. Did your panelists experience that as well? I think it's a beautiful question to finish with, actually. And it's a $1 million question too.
I absolutely feel like I walked through a version of internal, logistical, emotional, spiritual death in my cancer process. That in between that Teva Harrison names, for me, looked like very deep meditation, literally engaging with the goddesses of death. I spent hours meditating with Hecate and Persephone at my sides in this meditative pain space of trying to figure out how I would reconfigure. And one of my pieces is actually about that death and reconfiguration that's in this show. It's called Hope Cocoon. And it is representational of the cocoon phase of re-becoming after that internal death has caused an uprising.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We are at 7:05, and there is one comment that that Eva left that I wanted to read, and then I'm going to leave it to.
I don't know if Camille wants to respond as well the question, but I understand that
I'm feeling it. I'm running out of steam, so I feel like it's 11:00 here and I hadn't had dinner, so.
Yeah, because I was like, oh, maybe she could answer. And then I'm like, oh, but it's very late in the UK. So no. Okay. Sorry.
Yes, that's sort of why I jumped in, because I did see your message, Camille. But I did want to read out loud Eva Kerpinski's comment. She writes, she had to leave because her daughter had her birthday. Thank you for this powerful community making through sharing stories. Regarding your questions, who cares? Arthur Frank says about narratives of illness that stories take care of their narrators. His is a very individualistic, masculinist, and heroic framework. Nonetheless, what you have demonstrated today is the power of story sharing as taking care of communities, and reciprocally of community building as taking care of our mind bodies. I think she puts it very beautifully. And ditto for art practices also as communal experiences. I'm going to leave it to Roberta to close, because we also, Nina is here, so.
Yeah, I wanted to call Nina because she couldn't be here. She was in another meeting and they had technical difficulties as far as I understand. So I want to call Nina in and say a few words because I know that. And also, like, I know that she feels this these stories a lot. So. Yeah, please, Nina. We can't hear you because you're muted.
Okay,
good.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to say a couple huge thank yous, because it is so fantastic after decades of silence, if not hundreds of years of silence by women about intimate things about their own body, but it's also a social thing about everybody's body, half the population's body. I think this is the difference today, that you can talk and you are talking about things. And I really thank you, especially because I am one of these older women, and I can attest to the fact that old women have a lot prejudice going against them. But in any case, I thank you very much. And because I'm actually partly here because of Laser, I want to say also that this Leonardo Arts and Silence evenings are also living in this spirit, that we are quite independent all over the world. And wherever we have these events, here it is just a side story, the Laser, but that's all right. It is an unusual thing today that all over, from Iran to, and in 50 locations around the world, people come together and, for example, on these or other issues, can freely speak without any problems and discuss and debate. I thank you so much, both of you. It was really, really inspiring. And I am also a cancer survivor, so I know what you are talking about. Bye.
Thank you so much, Nina. I think this is a beautiful way to finish. Alanna, let's...
I just want to acknowledge the Shalika Sivatazan and Tom Worthington behind the scene, who have...
Thank you.
...spotlighting and the amazing work. And thank you, Camille. Thank you, Alanna. Please do come to the exhibitions. I invite you all. And our next appointment is, our immediate next appointment is Alanna's opening on Thursday 31st, after which next Friday, April 1st, there'll be a keynote on health myths and trickster viruses with Bayo Akomolafe and Sima Yasmin next Friday, same time. Well, looking forward to see you there. And then Camille's opening will be on the following Thursday, April 7th, down at New College. But check out our website.
And she will be here in Toronto. So,
yes, safe travels, Camille. Safe travels.
Okay, bye, everybody.